Hello everybody, welcome to NEET Crash Course Biology. Now we will be doing a quick synopsis of reproduction in organisms. So reproduction, as you know, is a necessary for every single species on this planet to ensure continuity of species. So you know that each and every organism reproduces and it can live for a specified period of time, and that specified period of time is referred to as the lifespan. Usually the lifespan does not necessarily correlate with the sizes of the organism, and death of every organism is something which is a certainty that is no individual, except in the case of single cell forms. They are mostly single cell forms are considered immortal. Other than them, most of them are mortal. Types of reproduction are asexual and sexual reproduction. Now, asexual reproduction does not involve formation of gametes or gamete fusion, but sexual reproduction involves formation of two types of gametes, that is the male and the female gametes, which involves the fusion to result in the formation of zygote. If you see some of the asexual reproduction, you have binary fission, where a cell splits into two as simple in case of amoeba, longitudinally when the division axis is along the longitudinal axis of the cell, it is in the case of Euglena, and transverse when the axis is horizontal in the case of Paramecium, Diatoms and Planaria, oblique when there is no definite axis for division. Remember, in binary fission, division actually takes place, resulting in one cell forming two cells. In multiple fission, one cell gives rise to more than two daughter cells in amoeba, plasmodium and monocystis, and during unfavorable condition, amoeba exhibits a type of phenomenon called sporulation, where it develops a cyst wall, a three-layered cyst wall as an encystment, following which it produces amoeboid or you can call them as pseudopodiospores, which start living an independent life, that is called sporulation. And then there are some cases where plasmotomy takes place, where initially the division occurs in the form of free nuclear divisions and later the cytoplasm is divided, as in the case of Opalina and Pilomyxa. Budding, if budding happens on the external side, like in the case of Hydra, Cycon and Salpa, then it is called exogenous budding. If budding happens inside, even yeast belongs to exogenous type of budding, and budding, if it happens on the inside of the body, then it is called internal budding. And then you can also see budding happening during the developmental stages of, say, for example, some forms like in Aurelia, and even you see how in the case of adult tapeworm, how segmentation or strobilation happens, which is a familiar type of, which is somewhat similar to what budding happens during asexual reproduction. So here you can see the pictures of how a hydra develops a protrusion on the body, the projection starts growing, and then it starts, it gets detached from the parent body, and then it starts leading an independent life. Gemmule is an example for internal buds, which are seen in freshwater sponges, and these are mostly meant to tide over unfavorable environmental conditions. And you can see how segmentation or strobilation happens in tapeworm. Fragmentation, when the body divides into many, many fragments and each fragment grows into an independent organism or the offspring, as in the case of algae, in bryophytes, even in some of the higher vascular plants, like for example in pteridophytes. Regeneration, as you can see in case of Planaria and also in case of Hydra, if you cut the body of an animal into individual parts or fragments, each of them develop into new parts, completely regenerated parts. It was first studied by Abraham Tremblay in 1740. It is reported mostly in sponges in Hydra and Planaria. Sporulation, what are the different types of spores? Now, spores also come under asexual reproduction because there is no formation of gametes or their fusion. Zoospores are motile spores. Conidia are non-motile thin-walled spores which are produced exogenously on specialized upright hyphae called conidiophores. Chlamydospores are thick-walled spores which may help in overcoming unfavorable condition. Oida is obtained by segmentation of hyphae, and these are thin-walled spores. And spores coming from specialized structures called sporangia are called sporangiospores. Mostly these sporangiospores may be motile or they may be non-motile. In case of rhizopus and mucor, they may be non-motile. So these are some of the types of asexual reproduction. Now we shall see vegetative propagation. In vegetative propagation, you can see how an individual parent plant develops into an offspring without the assistance of another individual. There is a single individual involved, and there are specific parts or specific organs in the plant body which takes part in formation of new plants, and these organs are referred to as vegetative propagules. So if, say for example, the root is giving rise to a new plant by the formation of a bud, we can call root as a vegetative propagule. propagule, as in the case of Dalbergia, Dahlia, Albizia, and Asparagus. Then you have all studied in morphology the different types of underground stems like tubers, which are meant for storage like in artichoke and potato. Bulbs are specialized highly condensed stem that you see in garlic, onion and narcissus. And then you have corms. Corms are also underground stem which develop at the base of the main axis or the main shoot. And then these corms also bear rings or nodes which are separated by internodes, and they bear scaly leaves and sometimes adventitious roots, and buds also are developed on the corm, like in the case of Zameenkand, that is Amorphophallus, Colocasia. Rhizomes, as you see in case of banana, ginger, rhizome is also an underground stem which has nodes at definite intervals with scaly leaves. And then you have suckers. Suckers is actually a horizontal branch that develops from the base of the main plant. It travels underground, it grows underground to a certain distance, and then it starts growing obliquely upwards, and on reaching the surface of the ground it gives rise to a daughter plant, as in the case of mint, banana and chrysanthemum. Even pineapple is an example for sucker. Subaerial stems. Subaerial stems means they are neither growing upright nor are they growing underground. They're growing along the surface of the ground, like in the case of runners of grass, stolon. If they arch upwards and offsets, which are like runners which grow horizontally on the ground without arching, and this is mostly seen in aquatic plants like Icornia. And some of the aerial stems are also modified for reproduction, like if you talk about phylloclade is an aerial stem where the stem itself becomes very green and succulent. It has multiple internodes, multiple nodes, and those nodes bear the leaves which are modified into spine in the case of Opuntia or cactus. Now here you can see the examples of runner. See how the runner is growing horizontally. It develops from the base of this stem, that is the main stem or the aerial shoot. It grows horizontally on the ground. At regular intervals it has nodes which give out a leafy shoot which grows upright. And see how the stolon, again if the stolon is emerging from the base of the main stem, and then you can see how it arches upward, then again it meets the ground. Where it meets the ground, it forms a new shoot and a new root system is formed. Again from the base of this shoot another stem grows which arches upwards, and then it meets the ground after a certain distance and gives rise to a daughter plant. And you can see an offset over here. An offset is something which is seen in aquatic plants only. It is very similar to a runner. It grows on the surface of water. It has a single internode. Then we have leaves, which help in reproduction because they develop adventitious buds. Remember, this is asexual reproduction or vegetative propagation. There is no involvement of gametes. There is no involvement of fusion. In this case, we are talking about organs of the plant body. There is no involvement of spores also. So in Begonia, Bryophyllum and Kalanco, from the margin of the leaves, buds develop adventitious buds, which are referred to as the foliar buds because they develop on the leaf. Even in the case of walking fern, the leaf tip assists in propagation. When the leaf tip comes in contact with the soil, a new plant is formed over there. So that is also an example for leaf helping in vegetative propagation. Sometimes buds, which develop into structures called bulbils, which help in vegetative propagation, like in Oxalis, Agave, Dioscorea, etc. And then you have Turion. Turion is also a bud which is mostly seen only in aquatic plants. So remember, these are also buds. You must have, you know that a bud develops mostly at the axil of the main axis as well as the branch. And this bud is usually found in aquatic plants like Potamogeton and Utricularia or Bladderwort. Now, how exactly is vegetative propagation carried out in artificial methods? It is carried out through cutting. It is carried out by root cutting. If you take a cut part of a root and sow it in the soil, you get a new plant. If you take a cut stem and if you sow it in the soil, it grows into a new plant. Sometimes you can cut a part of the leaf which has developed a bud on it and grow it in the soil, you can get a new plant. So accordingly they are called root cutting, stem cutting and leaf cutting. Then we have layering. A branch is bent and covered with the soil, and that particular part will develop into a new plant. Now for this you have to see the pictures to understand. In mound layering, what is done is the base of the stem is covered with a mound. See how a mound of soil is placed on the base of a stem, and this part of the stem is basically pruned, that is all the branches and leaves are cut off over here. And you can see whichever part that is the base of the stem that is covered with the mound of a soil starts developing roots of its own, and then you can cut off the branches and grow grow them as individual plants. So this is called mound layering. In air layering, you have taken a branch. See, this is a branch at the base of the branch, very close to where it starts branching from the mother axis. There you have peeled off the bark to expose the ring, that is the xylem tissue, and there you cover it with the clay. You put water, and sometimes you also introduce auxin, which is a rooting hormone, and you cover this portion, this injured portion, with a polythene bag, and you have put a grafting clay over there with water inside, with drops of water to keep it moist. Slowly adventitious roots will start growing, and then you can cut off this branch and grow it as an individual plant. This is called air layering or gootie. There are many other types of layering. Please remember simple layering, serpentine layering, trench layering, and tip layering. You should learn all these examples. Now, a picture showing the different types of layerings. You can see simple layering is basically only one branch is pegged, meaning it is anchored at one part, and here you can see the roots will start developing and a new plant will start developing. So you are anchoring the stem only at one part, and here you can see how at different parts the stem is anchored. So here is the first anchorage, here is the second anchorage, here is the third pegging. You're pegging it in the soil, and whichever part of the stem is pegged up in the soil, then that part of it develops adventitious root. So this usually the stem is basically organized in the form of a snake, and that's why it is called as serpentine layering. This is simple layering, this is serpentine layering. In trench layering, you simply make this branch sleep in a horizontal axis. See, you have just made it completely horizontal. It's literally sleeping on the ground, prostrate on the ground, and roots will develop on certain contact points. This is called trench layering. In tip layering, you're only bending the branch, and the tip of the branch is buried in the soil with a portion of it exposed, and wherever the burying happens, there the root is formed. Okay. Then grafting is another technique. In grafting, you connect the root system of one plant with the shoot system of another plant. The root system, or the part of the plant which contributes to the root, is referred to as the stalk. So stalk is connected to the part of the plant which you want to become the stem, which is referred to as the scion. So stalk and scion are connected to each other. Now see here, this is the stalk of a plant, of a different plant, and a scion of a different plant. See how oblique cuts are made in both of them. When oblique cuts are put together and tied up with each other, so now you can imagine when this plant starts producing fruits, what will the fruit be produced? Will the fruit belong to the stalk or fruit belong to the scion? It will obviously belong to the scion, isn't it? Because the stalk is only contributing the root system, whereas the scion is the one that forms the stem, that forms the floral primordium, that forms the flowers, that forms the fruit, etc. So always the flowers and the fruits belong to the scion, because the scion is the contributing factor for the stem in the case of grafting. See how the oblique cut parts of the scion and the stalk are met together, and they are basically put together, and they are joined together, and they become a complete plant. And that is in the case of tongue grafting. In wedge grafting, what you do is you make a wedge like cut in the scion, and you make a V-shaped depression on the stalk, and you oppose the parts and tie them up. In case of crown grafting, you take a stalk which is very, very broad, and you make incisions, you make slots on the stalk, and you insert small branches of scion into the stalk, and that starts growing as a plant after the cambium fuses with each other. In approach grafting, what you do is both the scion and the stalk, the plant which you want to use as a scion and the plant which you want to use as a stalk, they are still rooted to the ground. See, this particular plant you want to make this the scion, so it is still rooted, and this is the stalk. And then you bring the stems closer together, probably you make an incision, you remove the bark. You make sure that the incisions meet each other, and you tie them up with a thread, and later you can probably cut off this particular branch, and so now it becomes an independent plant, where you have taken the scion from the plant which you desire, and it is supported by the stalk of another plant. In case of bud grafting, you make a T-shaped incision on the branch. See how you've made on the bark, you've made a T-shaped incision, and in that incision you have inserted a bud. So the actual plant that grows from the bud, it belongs to the bud, but it is growing on a plant on which you have made a T-shaped incision. So this is referred to as the grafting. So now moving on to sexual reproduction. Now in sexual reproduction, you can imagine there is formation of male and female gametes. There's fusion of male and female gametes, resulting in formation of a diploid zygote. So it involves both gamete formation as well as it involves gamete, the zygote formation. That is, syngamy is a very important part of sexual reproduction. In sexual reproduction, you have to remember about two important types. One is called amphimixis or syngamy. Amphimixis or syngamy is the fusion of the gametes. The male gamete and the female gamete fuse to form a diploid zygote, and this process is referred to as amphimixis or syngamy. If you take post-fertilization changes in the flowering plants after the zygote, you all know that the zygote is present inside the ovule. Later, the ovule develops into the seed, isn't it? So most importantly, the ovule which has a developing embryo inside will ultimately become the seed. And then what happens to the ovary? You know that in the plant, the ovule is located inside the ovary. If you remember, the wall of the ovary becomes the pericarp, which is the fruit wall. See, the ovary develops into the fruit wall, and the pericarp, the fruit wall is referred to as pericarp. It protects the seed inside, and once the seed germinates under favorable condition, the seed will grow into a new plant. Now coming to parthenogenesis. What is parthenogenesis? Parthenogenesis refers to reproduction from an ovum without the act of fertilization. So egg is formed, gametes may be formed, but there is no fertilization. So formation of a young one directly from the ovum without any form, without fertilization or without contribution by the sperm is referred to as parthenogenesis. So we can see parthenogenesis occurs naturally in case of rotifers, in arthropods, in crustaceans, in arachnids, and there are also some vertebrates in which this parthenogenesis is a common feature, like Caucasian rock lizard, that is Lacerta saxicola, Armeniaca, and Typhlina bramina, which is a small snake of India, and even some birds exhibit, like turkey, they exhibit parthenogenesis. In parthenogenesis, as you can imagine, it is only the female parent that is involved in reproduction, because the egg of the female parent is developing into a young one without the contribution by the sperm. Okay, it is also seen, it may also be induced in some of the plants that is mentioned over here. Even in mammals, it can be induced. Natural parthenogenesis is something which is not induced. It is something which happens naturally as the part of life cycle of certain animals. If you take complete or obligatory parthenogenesis, then the animal does not have any other choice rather than breeding exclusively by parthenogenesis. Every time it has to reproduce, it has to reproduce only by parthenogenesis. It does not have any other option. That is called obligatory parthenogenesis. This is seen in case of the Caucasian lizard, that is Lacerta, as well as the blind snake, that is the smallest snake in India, that is the Typhlina bramina. Then if you talk about incomplete or facultative parthenogenesis, incomplete or facultative parthenogenesis means within the life cycle of an organism, during some seasons the organism may reproduce by parthenogenesis, during other seasons it may reproduce by sexual reproduction. So it involves both sexual reproduction and parthenogenesis. This type of reproduction where both parthenogenesis and sexual reproduction is involved, it is referred to as incomplete or cyclic parthenogenesis. Now the best example for incomplete or cyclic parthenogenesis is seen in honeybees, where the queens produce workers by parthenogenesis and drones are basically, sorry, the workers are produced by fertilization and the drones are produced by parthenogenesis. If the queen allows her egg to get fertilized by the sperm of the male, then the fertilized egg will develop into worker. So worker is coming without parthenogenesis by normal fertilization and development. But if the queen wants to produce male, then she will simply lay her egg will develop into a young one or an embryo without the contribution by the sperm, and therefore the drone or the male honeybee is obtained by parthenogenesis. Even in the case of aphids, see, during aphids, in aphids which are plant sap suckers, they are parasites, ectoparasites on plant. Now you can see during the spring season all the aphids are reproducing only by parthenogenesis. There will be lot of females in the colony, all of them will be parthenogenetic, but you can see during the end of the spring season, that is during the beginning of the fall, that is throughout summer, spring and summer, they're reproducing by parthenogenesis. But towards the end of summer and the beginning of the fall season, surprisingly, the female aphid by parthenogenesis is capable of producing both male and female aphids. Both of them are diploid. Now see what happens. There are separate male and female aphids. This is produced during the fall season. This part of the season is called the fall. Fall means the summer is over, winter is almost beginning. So at the end of the summer, the spring through summer, always remember this cycle is spring through summer, the female aphid reproduces through parthenogenesis, and when the time comes, that is in the fall season, that is about the winter is about to begin, that time what the female will do is again she is undergoing parthenogenesis, but surprisingly now during parthenogenesis she can produce male and female. So that means it's a type of a type of parthenogenesis which can generate both male and female. It's called amphitoki, isn't it? Now, if only females are produced, it is called teletoki. If only males are produced, it is called arenotoki. But here, the female at the beginning, at the end of summer or the beginning of the fall season is producing both male and female through amphitoki. And now see, the male and female are going to reproduce sexually. So this is the sexual phase. They reproduce sexually to produce diploid egg, and then after winter, in the next spring season, at the beginning of the spring season, the diploid eggs will hatch into the female, which is again capable of parthenogenesis. So this is called cyclical parthenogenesis that is seen in aphid. Now see, the egg, the embryo becomes enters into a state of inactivity, so we call it as the diapausing egg, because in the egg the embryo does not develop further throughout the winter season. Only at the onset of the spring season the egg hatches out into these females, which are capable of parthenogenesis. So remember, the females reproduce by parthenogenesis throughout spring and summer, and during the end of the summer, in this fall season, they produce both male and females, which reproduce sexually during the winter season to produce eggs. So therefore, half of its life cycle is involving the sexual phase, and half of its life cycle is involving parthenogenetic phase, and that's why it is called incomplete or cyclic parthenogenesis. It is not obligatory parthenogenesis, it is a type of facultative parthenogenesis. 40% male turkeys are produced by parthenogenesis. Turkey is a bird, so in turkeys about 40% of them are produced by parthenogenesis. 60% of the males and all the females are produced, the remaining females are produced by sexual reproduction. So males are produced by 40% of them by parthenogenesis in the case of turkey. There is a very peculiar phenomenon. In this peculiar phenomenon, you can expect parthenogenesis to happen in the larva itself. The larva itself starts producing new larvae. See, a larva is not supposed to reproduce because a larva has to become an adult first. But in this case, something very peculiar happens. The larva itself starts reproducing by parthenogenesis. It is called pedogenetic parthenogenesis. The best example is in case of liver fluke, where in liver fluke there are different larvae involved. If you remember, there's Miracidium larva, sporocyst larva, radia larva, cercaria larva. In this, the sporocyst and the radia larva both reproduce parthenogenetically to produce the next larval stage. Okay. So I told you, if parthenogenesis gives rise to male, it is called arenotoki. If parthenogenesis gives rise to female, only females, then it is referred to as teletoki, as it is occurring in some of the butterflies and moths, that is Lepidoptera, and lizards such as Lacerta, which is the Caucasian rock lizard, and Typhlina brahmina, which is one of the smallest snakes of India. And if parthenogenesis, like I told you, honeybees, in which the male becomes the drone, is a product of parthenogenesis, when the female just lays her egg without fertilization. So then I told you there are some cases, like in case of aphid, where they produce both male and female through parthenogenesis. When does it produce both male and female through parthenogenesis? Not in the summer or the spring season. At the end of the summer and the fall season, just before the winter season, the female produces both male and female aphids by parthenogenesis. When parthenogenesis results in formation of male and female sexes, it is referred to as amphitoki. So now moving on to the synopsis of the next chapter. The next chapter that we will be discussing is sexual reproduction in flowering plants. Sexuality was first discovered by Camerarius, specifically in plants, and it was Strasburger who discovered the true act of fertilization, that is syngamy, that is fusion between the male gamete and the female gamete. And this fusion or syngamy is also referred to as amphimixis. And you all know, it goes without saying, that in flowering plants, you all know there is a reproductive organ called flower. In the flower, there is a male part which is called the androecium, and the female part which is called the gynoecium. So here you can see the male part, which consists of anther and filament, which is collectively referred to as the stamen, and the female part is called the pistil or the carpel. We had learned that the pistil or the carpel, the swollen part is the ovary, the narrow part is the style, and the upper expanded part is the stigma. So the units of gynoecium are called pistil or carpel, and the units of androecium are called stamen. Notice how the stamen has these sac-like structures, which are called anther, and this filament below, that is the stalk, which is referred to as the filament. And then, you know, inside the anther, when you take a section of the young anther, you can see that there are four chambers or compartments inside, and these compartments or chambers that are present inside are called the thecae, and that's why we call it as bithecus, because each half of the anther, now you can divide the anther into two lobes, each lobe of the anther has two thecae or two compartments or two cases, and that's why it is called as bithecus anther or dithecus anther. And if you magnify the structure of the young anther, you can see that this compartment or case is referred to as the microsporangium. It is consisting of a uniform tissue in the center, which is called the sporogenous tissue, surrounded by four distinct walls. So remember that each microsporangium is a case which is made up of a tissue in the middle that is called the sporogenous tissue, and it is surrounded by four distinct layers. We saw that the anther produces the pollen. You all know that inside the sporogenous tissue, there is a pollen mother cell. The pollen mother cell undergoes meiosis to produce the microspore tetrads. Each microspore, which is haploid, becomes a haploid pollen grain. You all should remember that within the pollen grain, there is a larger cell, which is called the vegetative cell. And sitting in one corner in the vegetative cell is a smaller cell that is called the generative cell. Both of them have distinct nuclei of each other. The larger cell is the vegetative cell or the tube cell, and the smaller cell is the generative cell. And now notice how there are two membranes to the pollen grain. One is the outer membrane that is called exine, which is made up of a very special substance which is very, very resistant to high temperature and acids and alkali, which is called sporopollenin. Till today, they have not discovered any enzyme that can degrade this sporopollenin. And this internal wall is referred to as the intine, which is a continuous layer that is made up of cellulose and pectose. And notice wherever there is no exine, this particular region where there is no exine is referred to as the germ pore, through which the pollen tube grows out. Okay, so see how the pollen tube is formed. Now very soon what happens is, once the pollen tube is formed, you can see how the generative cell, initially it was pushed to a corner, now the generative cell has started, it becomes spindle shaped and it has started floating in the cytoplasm of the vegetative cell. Now this is the nucleus of the vegetative cell, as you can see over here. And then you can see how from the germ pore a tube is germinating. When it falls onto a stigma, it contains the nucleus of generative or the generative cell inside, and it is led by the nucleus of the vegetative cell. And very soon the generative cell divides into two spherical non-motile male gametes, which are also being passed down the pollen tube. That is, this happens by the time the pollen tube has started passing through the tissue of the style. So why should the pollen tube travel all the way down? Because its goal is to reach the ovule. This is the ovule, a typical anatropous ovule, because it is bent on its own axis. And you can see how this base of the ovule is called the chalaza. The opening of the ovule where there is no protective covering is called micropyle. There are two protective coverings of the ovule, an inner and outer integument. That's why we call such an ovule as a bitegmic ovule. And then inside the ovule, you have a tissue which is called the nucellus. The stalk of the ovule is called the funiculus. The point where the funicle joins the body is referred to as the hilum. And inside the ovule, you find a diploid tissue with lot of food reserve in it. It is called the nucellus. So remember that the nucellus is a diploid tissue, and inside the nucellus you can see a structure which is which I'm highlighting here, which is called the embryo sac. Inside the embryo sac, you have a large cell sitting in the center. And this cell with two nuclei is referred to as the central cell, and three cells at this pole are called antipodals, and three cells towards this pole are called the egg apparatus. You know that in the egg apparatus there is egg, there are two cells which are sitting one beside the other, and egg is hidden behind them. So these are the three cells which make up the egg apparatus. And you also know that these cells which are supporting the egg are referred to as the synergids. And what is unique about the synergids is, if this is a synergid, the inner wall of the base of the synergid will have finger-like projections, the cell wall, and this is known to guide the pollen tube, and this is the one that is referred to as filiform apparatus. So the pollen tube has to come all the way down, isn't it? Now let us see how the ovule develops. In the ovule, we saw that there is a 7-celled, 8-nucleate structure called embryo sac. See how it develops. Initially, when the ovule is immature, a cell gets differentiated towards the micropyle that is called the megaspore mother cell. The megaspore mother cell undergoes meiosis 1 to form a megaspore dyad, which then undergoes meiosis 2 to form a megaspore tetrad. Out of the tetrad, three of them die and only one is retained. That is called the megaspore, the prominent megaspore, which is haploid, and that divides by free nuclear divisions. Only the nucleus divides initially. And how many free nuclear divisions are seen? 3 free nuclear divisions are seen in order to form a group of 7 cells and 8 nuclei. And see the central cell over here, which I'm going to show you the boundary now. And this cell, which is sitting in the center of the embryo sac, which has 2 nuclei, is called the central cell. The group of cells at the chalazal end are called antipodals, and the group of cells towards the other end, along with the 2 synergids and the egg sitting in the center, constitutes the egg apparatus. And I told you, if this is the synergid, so 2 synergids are sitting and egg is hidden between them, is hiding between them. And I told you that the inner wall of the synergid, the cell wall, shows finger-like projections, which are referred to as filiform apparatus. And this filiform apparatus is what guides the entry of the pollen tube into the synergid. Pollination, you all are aware, when pollen grain from the anther falls onto the stigma, it is referred to as pollination. Why pollination is very important? Because pollen grain carries male gamete, which is non-motile. So somehow it has to be transported to the female plant, that is the female part of the plant, so that it can reach the female gametophyte. You know, now you should remember that the 7-celled 8-nucleate embryo sac itself is referred to as a highly reduced female gametophyte. And why should pollination occur? So that the pollen falls on the stigma, and then we saw the pollen forms a pollen tube, it reaches the ovule, and then it fertilizes the ovule. So Cole Rooter recognized the significance of pollination in the seed setting and the role of insects in pollination. If pollination happens within the same flower, it is called autogamy. If a flower opens and if its anther and stigma are exposed to the outside, it is called chasmogamous. If pollination happens in the bud condition, where the anther dehisces while the flower is still not open and it fertilizes the ovum, or the it falls onto the stigma of the flower and it fertilizes the ovum sitting inside the ovule, then it is called cleistogamous. Because in cleistogamous flowers, the flowers do not open at all. The flowers remain closed, but most importantly, you have to say that inside the bud condition, when the flower remains closed, the anther dehisces and the pollen falls on the stigma. Cleistogamy, that's what I was telling you, the flower does not open. And in bud pollination, that's what we were saying, while the flower is still a bud condition, when it still hasn't opened up, its anther and its stigma are not exposed to the outside, the anther dehisces inside and the pollen falls onto the stigma. Allogamy is gitinogamy. Gitinogamy is functionally cross-pollination because it happens between 2 flowers of the same plant, that is neighboring flowers. Remember, gitinos means neighbor. So 2 flowers on the same plant, it may happen between 2 flowers on the same plant. So basically, functionally, it is cross-pollination, but genetically, it could be self-pollination. Xenogamy is pollen falling onto the stigma of an entirely different plant. How is xenogamy brought about? It is brought about by abiotic agents like wind and water, and biotic agents like animals. If it is brought about by wind, it is referred to as anemophily. All of you remember one thing, that pollination carried by wind, because pollen needs to be carried to the stigma, and if wind is the medium of pollen being carried, then we call it as water pollination, or it is called wind pollination, or it is referred to as anemophily. So for anemophily, the pollen grains have to be light and non-sticky, the stamen has to be exposed, the stigma has to be feathery, so that if wind brings the pollen, it has to capture them. There has to be a single ovule to increase the chances of pollination and fertilization, and all the ovules of flowers must be arranged into a cluster to increase the chances of pollination, and also to make the flowers more obvious. So basically, to make them small and arranged in the cluster is so that if pollen comes, they can at a time grab all the pollen, and at a time many seeds can be formed. So you have a flower with many florets in it, not just a single flower. And flowers are not colorful because wind is pollinating them. There's no need to bribe anybody for this. And a large number of pollen grain are released, surprisingly, some of them when they enter into the air, and when they are remaining there as a suspended particle, then it can also lead to certain severe allergic conditions in humans, and that is referred to as hay fever. Okay. Hydrophily is the type of pollination that is mediated by water. It is the agency of water. We have learnt about Vallisneria, Ceratophyllum, and mostly Zostera, that is marine. Vallisneria pollination happens on the surface of water, so it is called epihydrophily. But if you talk about Zostera, that is marine grass, in that the pollination happens underwater, so it is called hypohydrophily. Okay. Flowers are small and inconspicuous. Even in the case of water pollination, flowers are small. Nectar and odor are absent because they don't have to bribe water. Water is a non-living thing. It doesn't expect anything in return. And stigma is long, but it is unwettable because it's covered by mucilage. Because if constantly the flowers are getting wetted, then they may start decaying. As a result, there should be a coat of mucilage on the pollen grains and even on the stigma, like we already learned about the examples, Vallisneria, Ceratophyllum, and Zostera. Entomophily is you need to bribe the insects to pollinate. Insects will only get attracted to a flower if they get something in return, like if they get pollen or if they get honey. And mostly for you to attract them, the flower has to be having a lot of fragrance. It should have beautiful colors and patterns to attract the insects, isn't it? So large, colorful, fragrant, and rich in nectar to bribe the insects. Sometimes some insects love foul odors, so sometimes in flies and beetles, to attract flies and beetles, the flowers may also develop foul odors. Like for example, if you see the largest flower in the plant kingdom, which is Rafflesia, it usually exudes the odor of rotten meat because it attracts the flies, which love the smell of rotten meat. So they have a large amount of sticky pollen so that they can get stuck to the body of the insects. When the flowers are small, they're usually clustered into an inflorescence to make it very obvious to the pollinator that, oh, there is a flower, I should go and pollinate it. Otherwise, there's single flowers which are very, very small, then they may not even be noticed by the pollinator, isn't it? Some flowers provide safe haven for laying eggs, like the giant, the tallest flower, which is basically Amorphophallus, which can grow up to about 7 feet. In some cases, the petals are not conspicuous, but other parts like sepals become very showy, like in the case of bougainvillea and euphorbia, and spathes in case of aroids. One of the sepal becomes like a petal in case of musanda, and stamens also become petal-like, petaloid stamens in mimosa and acacia. All this is an attempt to attract the pollinator insect. Sometimes animals are also involved. Animals may include birds and other animals. It may include insects also in some cases. So birds, and then if you talk about larger primate animals, like for example, lemurs are also known to exhibit, are also known to help in exchange of pollen onto the stigma. So they also help in pollination. And there are certain flowers which mimic the opposite sex. They are also called sex providing flowers. They mimic the opposite sex of certain wasps like Ophrys and Colpa. And when they get attracted to the flower thinking that it is a wasp of an opposite sex, and they try to mate with the flower, called pseudocopulation, and that is when the pollen that gets dusted on their body or the pollen that they've carried from some other flower gets dusted onto the stigma of this particular flower. Ornithophily is mostly by sunbirds, basically birds. Pollination by birds is referred to as ornithophily. Sunbirds and hummingbirds and some other pollinating birds and common pollinated plants. You have to know the examples like Wombax, Erythrina, coral tree, Callistemon, bottlebrush, Butea monosperma, which is called the flame of the forest, and Bignonia, Lobelia, Agave, and Grevillea robusta, which is the silver fir. Chiropterophily, Chiroptera means bat, so pollination by bat. This is seen in Caigilia pinnata, that is sausage tree, Adansonia, the baobab tree, which is the largest tree, which has a very, very thick trunk to it. It is very massive in its trunk. It's very common in Africa, the Adansonia baobab. And Anthocephalus, which is called the Kadamba tree, the Anthocephalus Kadamba. And then you have the Bauhinia megalandra, that is the camel's footprint tree. These are some of the examples for bat-pollinated plants. Malacophily is something which is mediated by mollusks. Malacos meaning soft animals, so that is mollusca, which is snail pollination, like as Aricima, which is the snake or the cobra plant. And even in the case of some arum lilies, which are aroids, which have corm in their underground at the base of their stem. Outbreeding devices. How do plants overcome self-pollination? They don't want to. They want to discourage self-pollination and they want to encourage cross-pollination. So these are devices for cross-pollination. Contrivances means devices. Contrivances to ensure cross-pollination, or contrivances for cross-pollination and against self-pollination. Dicliny means the flowers are unisexual. Either the male flower or the female flower are born separately on the same plant body in case of monoecious plant like in maize, and in different plant body like in papaya, dates and mulberry. So producing unisexual flowers is the best idea because there is no pollination, there is no self-pollination possible at all. In dichogamy, you make sure that the anther and the stigma don't mature at the same time. If the anther matures first, it is called protandry. If the gynae, that is the pistil matures first, the stigma matures first, it is called protogyne. So obviously when the both the anther and the stigma are not matured at the same time, then there is no question of self-pollination happening, because one of the most important things about self-pollination is there should be synchrony between the maturation of anthers and the stigma. Prepotency, see how the pollen grain of another flower, it wins the race, it germinates more quickly on the stigma than the pollen grains of the same flower. And this is something which is called prepotency. And self-sterility, if pollen of the same flower falls on the stigma of the same flower, then it does not achieve seed formation, there is no fertilization, this is called self-sterility. Heterostyly in lythrum, there are different levels. The sometimes in some flowers the stigma is very tall, the anther is medium height and the anther is very short. In some plants the stigma is very short and the anther is very tall. So one of them is tall, one of them is short, so obviously the pollen will not get, even the anther is too tall, the pollen may get carried away by the wind, and the stigma is very short, so it may not fall on the stigma at all. And obviously when the stigma is very tall, when the style is very tall, then obviously it goes out of reach of the anther. So when the height varies of the anther or of the stem or the stigma or the pistil, then we refer to as heterostyly. The best example is triheterostyly. There are three different arrangements of anther, that is stamen and pistil, in the triheterostyly arrangement of lythrum. Hercogamy is, there is a physical barrier. There are some barriers which will not allow the insect, like for example in a flower called Aristolochia, once a bee enters, once an insect enters the plant, it will not be allowed to exit the plant until and unless the pollen is collected from that. So there is a trap which traps the insect inside. So it enters a young flower in which the gynecium is matured already, it is called protogynous. When it has entered, it has carried pollen with it from another flower, the old flower in which the pollen has matured. It does the stigma with the pollen and gets trapped inside, because until and unless it does not get to carry the pollen of that particular flower, it will not be allowed to go out of that flower. It is called the trap mechanism in the case of Aristolochia. Then we need to learn about fertilization. As you know, in fertilization, there is the entry of the pollen tube into the embryo sac. See how it may enter. It may enter through micropyle, it may enter through chalaza, it may enter through integument, but ultimately it has to reach in through the pollen tube, isn't it? I mean, reach into the micropyle end. In the micropyle end, notice how the pollen tube with the male gamete is entering one of the synergids. See, one of the synergids it is entering, and then it ruptures, releasing the male gamete. So this is one male gamete, this is the other male gamete. One of the male gamete fuses with the egg, the other male gamete fuses with the diploid nucleus of the primary endosperm cell, which is called the primary endosperm nucleus. And this is why we call this process as double fertilization, because it involves two fertilization. One is called amphimixis and one is endosperm formation. One of the male gametes fuses with the egg nucleus or the egg gamete that is located in the egg apparatus to form the zygote. The other male gamete fuses with the primary endosperm nucleus, which has by now become a secondary nucleus after the fusion of the two polar nuclei, to result in the formation of a triploid endosperm. So stages in the development of a dicot embryo. You can see how in a dicot embryo, the zygote that is formed inside the ovule, it initially becomes a two-cell stage. There is a suspensor cell towards the micropyle and the terminal cell or the embryonal cell towards the chalaza, which develops into a globular stage embryo and then a heart-shaped embryo, and how the heart-shaped embryo takes the shape of an embryo bearing two cotyledons. The same process in the case of monocots, but in monocots there is only one cotyledon, the shield-like cotyledon that is developed in the seed surrounding the developing embryo is referred to as, and you see how this is called the scutellum, and the embryonic axis consists of the shoot apex or the plumule and the root apex or the radical, the root tip or the radical, covered by sheets which are called as coleoptile and coleorhiza respectively. Here are some seeds, how you can see in dicot seeds, you can see two cotyledons, how the cotyledons were formed during embryonic development, but these cotyledons become mature in size, they become huge in size, and they occupy much of the space or the much of the structure of the seed, and this tiny structure sitting inside is nothing but the embryo, which consists of a plumule, radical and hippocotyl and hypocotyl, etc. In a maize seed, you can see how the embryo is pushed towards one corner of the seed. Much of the seed is occupied by endosperm. And one more important thing is, in a maize seed, there's a yellow colored covering outside. And this yellow colored covering is the fruit wall. The seed coat and the fruit wall fuse together, and that's why it is called caryopsis or grain. Parthenocarpy is the formation of fruit without fertilization. So obviously the fruit will be seedless. It may be vegetative parthenogenesis, parthenocarpy, or stimulative parthenocarpy. In vegetative parthenocarpy, the seedless fruits can develop without without the stimulus of pollination. So even pollination is not required. Without pollination itself, the fruit wall develops, starts developing. There's no fertilization of the egg sitting inside the embryo sac over here. So that is why it is called vegetative parthenocarpy. So remember, in stimulative parthenocarpy, you need to give a stimulus, like for example, at least pollination should happen. Fertilization will not happen anyway, and the fruit wall will develop, as we can see in the case of grape seeds. In the grapefruit, and when you buy parthenocarpic grapes, you will not find seeds inside. The number of fruit varieties like banana, navel orange, pineapple, and grapes have been altered by parthenocarpic development. Hormonal treatment, sometimes by treating it with auxins and gibberellin, can also induce, like for example, auxins can induce the development of tomato without any seeds, that is parthenocarpy in the case of tomato. Remember, parthenocarpy means only the fruit is developing, seed is not there because fertilization also maybe did not happen. So development of a fruit without fertilization is called parthenocarpy. Now coming to the last bit in this chapter, which is referred to as apomixis. In apomixis, we all saw how the seed is formed. The seed is formed as a result of fertilization. Here, there is no fertilization involved, and meiosis may be involved. We are not talking about meiosis here. There is formation of seed without fertilization. Embryo is formed without fertilization. It was discussed, the term was provided by Winkler. It can be of two types, agamospermia and vegetative reproduction. Let us talk about agamospermia. In agamospermia, there is formation of seed without fusion of gametes, without the formation of a zygote. Okay, now what are the different types of agamospermia? Remember, in higher plants, agamospermia and apomixis are used interchangeably. In recurrent apomixis, you can imagine a diploid embryo is formed from egg itself becomes diploid. How does the egg become diploid? The egg becomes diploid because the embryo sac did not undergo meiosis. The embryo sac is a product of mitosis. If the embryo sac is a product of mitosis, every single cell in the embryo sac will become diploid. And when such a diploid egg cell develops into an embryo within the seed without fertilization, it is called recurrent apomixis. And where did the embryo sac come from? Based on that, there are two types. If the embryo sac comes from just any cell of the nucellus, it is called apospory. If the embryo sac comes from the cell which is destined to become the embryo sac, which is the megaspore mother cell, which is differentiated towards the micropyle. If you remember, when the ovule starts developing the embryo sac, one of the cells closer to the micropyle will be differentiated. It becomes the primary archisporial cell. That archisporial cell will itself become the megaspore mother cell. If the embryo sac comes from the megaspore mother cell, like how it is in most of the cases, we call it as diplospory, otherwise it is called apospory. But what is the ultimate thing here? Ultimate thing here is the megaspore mother cell itself became an embryo sac because it did not undergo meiosis. In recurrent apomixis, the embryo sac is a product not of meiosis, but it is a product of mitosis. In non-recurrent apomixis, the embryo sac does undergo meiotic division because the megaspore that is formed will undergo, the megaspore mother cell will produce megaspore by meiosis, and each haploid megaspore out of the four, three will die and one will remain, and that will produce a haploid embryo sac. So the embryo sac that is produced is haploid, and some parts of the embryo sac may become the embryo. Say for example, the haploid egg may become an embryo, the antipodal may become an embryo, the synergid may become an embryo, then it is called non-recurrent apomixis. If it comes from the haploid egg, it is referred to as haploid parthenogenesis. If the embryo comes from a synergid or an antipodal, which is not the egg, then it is called apogamy. Adventive polyembryonies, forget about the embryo sac here. In the first two cases, we were only concerned about embryo sac. In recurrent, we saw the embryo sac itself was diploid because the megaspore mother cell did not undergo meiosis. In the second case, we saw we do get a haploid embryo sac because meiosis is involved. But in adventive polyembryony, we have nothing to do with the embryo sac. It is something to do with the tissues in the ovule other than the embryo sac, which is called sporophytic tissue, say the nucellar tissue and the integument, which was present before the time of embryo sac development. Nucellus is present from the beginning. Integument is present from the beginning. And nucellus and integument has nothing to do with embryo sac. Nucellus and integument represents the sporophytic generation. If any cell in the nucellus or integument develops into an embryo, then we call it as adventive embryony. And if there are more than one embryo formed, it is called adventive polyembryony. Because it is a cell other than the embryo sac, it is a cell of the nucellus or the cell of the integument that is involved in producing new embryos in the seed, we call this as sporophytic budding. I told you about non-recurrent apomixis, where apogamy, this is called apogamy. Apogamy means in non-recurrent apomixis, the embryo sac is formed by undergoing meiosis. Some of the haploid cells of the embryo sac, like the synergid or the antipodal, may become embryos on their own, that is without the act of fertilization, when they are not supposed to be. Only the egg is supposed to be the embryo, but here you're seeing the synergid becomes the embryo, the antipodals become the embryo. So what is basically happening here is any cell other than the egg in the embryo sac, when the embryo sac is a product of meiosis, that's why the embryos in both the case are haploid. Whenever the resulting seed has a haploid embryo, it becomes sterile, and therefore we call this as non-recurrent, means it cannot be repeated in the next generation, because when you carry out, or when non-recurrent apomixis happens, the resulting seed or the embryo will be haploid, because it either came from a haploid egg or a haploid synergid or a haploid antipodal, and it cannot produce seeds of its own because a haploid plant is sterile. So then polyembryony is when there are many, many embryos developing inside the ovule. Like, for example, in simple polyembryony, suppose an ovule has more than one embryo sac. It's actually a case of false polyembryony, because an embryo has, an ovule has more than one embryo sac. So obviously you will expect more than one embryo. Cleavage polyembryony is one embryo splits into two, like in the case of Orchidaceae and even in the case of Citrus. So it may happen when the embryo is dividing at a certain stage, and then it breaks into two parts, and then each of them take shape of their own embryos. This is called cleavage polyembryony. And the last one is adventive polyembryony. Like we saw, adventive polyembryony is when any cell other than the gametophyte, any cell other than the embryo sac, is involved in formation of new embryos. Like in the case of in Citrus, you have nucellar embryos that are obtained from a tissue other than the embryo sac, which is nucellus. In Allium odorum, you can see how even from the integument of the ovule, the embryos are produced. So with this, we complete the synopsis of two major chapters, reproduction in organisms and sexual reproduction in flowering plants. Thank you.